No. When we get imported plants into the UK, and particularly here, or say for example, anywhere other than southwest of England or the southeast, where we can rely on fairly warm temperatures, particularly the southwest, where they get the warmer air coming up from South America. Whereas here, we're not going to get that. So we're looking at lower temperatures. We're looking at much lower temperatures. We're looking at much lower sunlight intensity levels throughout the year. This is where we're taking trees out of their preferred climate and putting them into somewhere where they're not ideally suited. Yes, they'll survive, but they're not going to thrive unless we make lots and lots of effort to force them to do that. And so applying Japanese techniques to them, Japanese timings, as we've seen in a lot of the translated articles, which I do, and the things that you see on the internet, other people's blogs and stuff, if we apply those techniques to our trees here, we're going to end up with a lot of strange looking trees, and some dead ones. So what we have to do is understand the objectives that we're looking to achieve, and think about the techniques in which we can achieve that. So it may be an adaptation of the Japanese techniques, or it may be something completely different. As I said on Friday night, there's many ways to skin a cat. Okay, so in order to reduce needle length, there's lots of different ways. So for black pines and red pines, we could either go the direction of adapting those techniques to us, or we can adapt our environment to make it more like Japan. And by that I mean keeping things in a greenhouse, giving them artificial sunlight, keeping the temperature and the humidity up. But the more things that you do where you're taking a tree, when you're creating this sort of artificial climate, the more chance you have for messing up. And so, you know, it makes things a lot more difficult. So it's much better, in my opinion, to try to find a way in order to make them survive out on your bench, where you're not going to have to completely baby them and you know, wrap them in cotton wool. So what does that mean?
Will you still put them in the winter?
Oh yeah, yeah. But they've got to have sunlight in the winter. That's the big difference. You know, if you look at the temperatures and such like from, if you compare, just for argument's sake, London and Tokyo, temperature-wise, it's not that. You know, we're not looking at 20 degrees difference, temperature mm-hmm. difference. We're only looking at maybe a few degrees. The big difference is rain levels and sunlight levels. Okay, so it's not necessarily the cold, because we don't get super cold here. No, you're not getting down to minus 20 or anything like that. We don't generally get that cold.
It's usually just
but
wet.
It's just wet and it's grey. Mm. It's miserable. And so that's the key thing. So if we can keep them fairly dry over the winter and as sunny as possible, then we'll have a lot more success. As I said, I used to have a growing lamp on my pines and stuff in a 6 foot greenhouse, 8 foot greenhouse, and that kept them very happy. Not so that they were growing throughout the winter, just mm-hmm. so they were ticking over.
Well, can it stay out over the winter, or?
If you're going to keep it out, then make sure it's covered.
It can go under cover.
You can just keep it under cover, and ideally facing the sun. And then out of north winds as well. You know, if you've got the Baltic winds coming down, then that'll make them unhappy. So how can we, you know, this is sort of nothing doing to it, and it's fairly healthy. You know, so the trees will grow, but once you start knocking them back by, say for example, candle cutting, that's mm-hmm. when you're going to start running into problems. So, like candle cutting on a whole tree basis, I think, is going to be quite unsuccessful for us. So how can we maintain a short needle length and try to increase the bud density? I mean, for a tree like this, we've got a lot of buds on there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's a full image. And so really what we're looking at doing is maintaining that.
Mm-hmm.
And so what we should be looking at doing is keeping it healthy. Is this bird crap on here?
Yeah.
Okay. So what we should be looking at doing is making sure that we've got good, healthy growth throughout the tree. And so we will be looking at needle density, balancing that up. So if we look here, we've got a lot of strong, healthy, vigorous growth here, and slightly weaker growth mm-hmm. on the inside. So what we can do at the top is, did you candle cut this year?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
But some of it, no, not all of it.
Okay, so just the bits that were candle cut.
Yeah.
When did you do it?
June.
Okay, so you're following the Japanese textbooks. Mm-hmm. So following that and the winter that we the summer that we didn't have.
Yeah, just
we've got a second flush of growth that hasn't opened out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you'd have done that in early May,
mm-hmm.
then that growth may have had the chance to have opened out.
But I'll know that now for sort of next year.
Yeah.
So what about those candles that are on it? Will they?
They'll open next year.
Next year. And then they can be cut as normal?
I would leave it. I'd just let them open out.
Mm-hmm.
Because you may end up just having the same problem again.
Mm-hmm.
Do we generally get two bonnings of black pines in the UK?
If we get a nice hot summer,
mm-hmm, which we didn't get this year,
and you do it early enough, then yes, you can be done. And the tree is like super healthy, it's super full of energy, then it can be done. But generally, anybody who does it and is successful with it has put things in greenhouses in the summer and really pushed it hard.
So basically, we're better with just one candle on them for the sake of the tree.
You are going to have, I mean, for a tree like this where we've got a full image, then I'd recommend that you just do one. Just let it go through its normal cycle every year, because we're not looking at doubling the number of buds every single year. If you really, you know, wanted to get an even higher needle density and start to get it even more ramified, then you're going to have to start looking at greenhouses over the summer and artificial lights over the winter and stuff like that,
because
you have to extend your growing season by effectively 2 months. Is what it boils mm-hmm. down to.
Yeah.
So if you can do that, then you can start looking at candle cutting to increase density. Because what candle cutting does is, like, so for example, if you see here, there was one candle cut, mm-hmm. and then we've got two shoots. So that's what you can achieve. So you've got to make your decision one way or the other. And that's, you know, it's not an aesthetic thing. It's a how much time and effort can you put into it? You know, how much money can you sink into it if you are looking at putting artificial lights on? Because they're, you know, you're looking at maybe £50 a year on your electricity bill, possibly.
Mm.
Just do it at your mum's, huh?
No,
do you hear that, Mrs. Warren?
She probably will do that. So if we're not going to do it, how are we going to get short needles? Okay, so we're looking at restricting growth, and so if we go down the path of not candle cutting, then we should not be fertilising early in the spring.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we should be looking at kind of trying to restrict the growth through withholding fertiliser. you're not live streaming this. So we should be looking at restricting growth through holding back fertiliser. If you are looking at doing candle cutting, then we have to do the opposite. Okay, so you've really got to make this decision, which way are you going to go along? Are you going to go along with, let's push it really hard and get two flushes of growth a year, or are we going to have a year of slow growth?
Mm-hmm.
It's got to be one or the other. And this kind of applies to a lot of the pines that we have, the Scots pines and things. You either push it really hard and keep cutting back, or you hold off and restrict the growth. But the fundamental idea, no matter what you're going to do, is well-balanced growth. And you will do that through how many needles we have around the buds. Okay, so if you're looking at trying to restrict the growth, then reducing the number of needles, we'll do that. If you're looking at boosting growth, then having more needles there, so not plucking them, we'll do it. This is your fundamental kind of basic ideas. Now, in terms of this tree, what we should be looking at perhaps doing is, at the moment, we've got this branch here, which is a big problem, sort of poking us in the eye. However, do we want to remove it?
I know, I've been looking at that for ages. And
Possibly. If we are looking at keeping it, then we're going to have to change the front a little.
Yeah.
So, is that going to, looking at it from there, is that going to be a possibility? So we have a very, one of the problems with this branch is not only the positioning of it, but also the thickness of it. So if we look at the thickness from underneath, the thickness of this branch compared to the heaviness of that one up there.
Thinner than the one above.
The one at the back isn't so much of a problem because it's hidden to a certain extent.
Mm-hmm.
And so we can tweak the front so that we aren't seeing the base of this thick, heavy branch. But no matter what we do, whether we look at it from here or kind of around there, we're always going to be seeing this, the thickness of that branch. And so we're always going to be comparing that lower branch with the one up above it.
To the left or to the right?
There would be more negative space within the bottom section of the tree. And so yes, you're right, that would introduce more movement, more.
You would see it better. You would see.
And again, if it's going into the show and display, you'd want the move to have sort of movement to one side or the other, because
I've done what he's doing, tweaked it around quite a few times to.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, my decision would be to remove it.
To remove it, yeah.
But that doesn't necessarily make it the best or the right decision, should we say. And there are. Yeah, it's not my tree at the end of the day. The real character of this tree is going to come from the thick trunk and the bark that's beginning to form on it. And so I think without seeing that, I mean, looking at just the foliage, it's not that interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And like I say, I mean, if we were in Japan, we could expect to get needle length that size.
Mm-hmm.
Then you could say, okay, well, we could make the foliage, the character point.
Mm-hmm.
But unless you are you know, super obsessively dedicated to it, mm-hmm. then you're going to struggle to achieve that in the UK. So I would perhaps look at making the trunk much more of a character feature. So removing that branch.
You wouldn't leave a gender in there, you'd just take it off totally right to the trunk? Or would you leave a bit for dieback?
No, I mean, you don't have to worry about dieback on the part. I mean, you could leave a tiny little bit of gin, but it's not a severe looking tree.
Yeah, I think it would take away from
creating that image of it being up in the mountains. So I'd remove that and then either slightly that way, and let's look at trying to bring this down a bit more. Mm-hmm. Making it the tree sort of flow a little bit more that way. That would probably be my recommendation. Mm-hmm. That would be it. So, in terms of how to maintain it,
yeah.
What we'd be looking at doing is constantly restricting strong growth.
Mm-hmm.
From getting away and looking at assisting weaker growth on the inside. So where we've got very high bud density, we'll be looking at perhaps thinning it out,
mm-hmm.
And removing the strong shoots. So for example, that one.
Yeah.
We've got weaker shoots around it, but you have to check that you've got enough around it in order to fill the space. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 7, so you'll be looking at removing that one. Good, that one off. Okay, so the removal of that strong bud. We'll leave the foliage on there because there's what appears to be a very small bud forming at the base. Okay, so the removal of that strong bud is now going to distribute the energy around there perhaps a little more evenly. And if you just constantly look to assist the weak and restrict the strong, then the tree will, over the course of several years, it will start to become very, very well balanced, and you'll get even growth throughout the tree. But it's a case of constantly trying to stay on top of that balance. So throughout the year, you'll be looking at making sure that the new growth doesn't get too long.
Yeah.
By either pinching the tips out of the strong growth, or mm-hmm. cutting it off entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Keeping the needle density the same throughout the tree, not over fertilising.
Mm-hmm.
And things like that. When looking at wiring trees like this, what we should be looking at doing is just trying to.
The wire on it it was not made. Yeah. I meant to get off. It's come with that wire on it.
It's very it's very difficult to wire.
Mm-hmm.
Shoving Japanese black pines, yes. And not mess the needles up. That's the big difficulty, because the needles snap very easily.
Mm-hmm.
So and it's very, very fiddly work. So what we should be looking at doing is just trying to wire those main branches. Not try to do too much fine work, because the finer work that we get in there, the more likely we are to damage the needles and to actually set the tree back. So I was just looking at trying to set the main structure and then have all the, kind of similar to what I was saying about the taxus area, just having all that the growth sort of coming up off it. All the buds are naturally going to kind of grow in the right direction, and when we have got sort of two or three buds from one spot, or when we're getting adventitious buds, we need to be very careful and choose the ones that you're actually going to be growing in the right directions. So when we start to see buds that are growing down and are kind of destroying the the image of it, then we remove those. We shouldn't be looking at, unless you are like super skilled with fine wire and can get in there and not damage the needles, then I would advise that trying to put as little wire on there as possible is a good thing. So just things that are getting really out of shape.
Mm-hmm. Much wiring on the main bits, will it? The main bits need much positioning on it.
Well, are we going to cut that branch off?
Yeah.
Okay, so you want to do it now?
Yeah, okay. Just cut it off. Thank you. That's better. Okay. How have you
been saying? I think that wire may not hold at all, actually. So if you could take that off later, and I'll help you to put some more on. So yeah, if you could also take this the fine wire off that's up in the top there, and we'll just re-jig the apex a little. I mean, it's the foliage on this is because you've candle cut. We've got this combination of like soft shoots that are not open, and hardening foliage is beginning to become hard, hard enough. So that's what makes it so difficult to wire without damaging it.